In this video, we derive the standard equations for constant acceleration kinematics in one dimension. We start with a reminder of the derivative relationships between position, velocity, and acceleration. And I'll post a link real quick to the video where we establish these by using the limit definition of the derivative. Next, we make a critical assumption. We want to look just at the case where the acceleration is a constant. So everything we derive from this point forward counts only for that case where the acceleration is constant. If you run into a case where acceleration is not constant, all bets are off and you have to go back to the fundamentals and look at derivatives and integrals again. And then the final piece to get ready here is we're going to use the symbol x-naught for the initial position and v-naught for the initial velocity. So again, we're starting from the assumption that our acceleration function is actually a constant, and I'm just going to use the letter a for that. And then I think to myself, how do I get the velocity function? And since the derivative of velocity gives acceleration, well, that means velocity is the antiderivative of this acceleration function, where a is a constant there. So I guess the antiderivative, and that's an at, but to be as general as possible, I have to put in an arbitrary constant plus c. Now the standard trick is to evaluate v at t equals 0, and that gives me a times 0, which vanishes, plus c. And I just found out that c is the initial velocity v of 0, and we have a special symbol for that, v naught. So now we can rewrite our velocity function as v of t equals v naught plus at. And this is our first equation for constant acceleration kinematics. And now I continue this process to find an expression for the position as a function of time. Well, if position is the thing you differentiate to get velocity, then it's the antiderivative of this velocity function. And again, I'll go through term by term guessing antiderivatives. V naught t is the thing you differentiate to get V naught. And then using the power rule for antiderivatives, 1/2 at squared is the thing you differentiate to get at. And to be as general as possible, we put in an arbitrary constant plus c. And then I use the same trick when I evaluate this position at t equals 0. The first two terms vanish, and I'm left with a c, and then I realize that c is x of 0, which I could write as x naught. Moving that to the beginning of the expression for x, I arrive at my second kinematics equation. X is x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. Again, the only reason these came out to the equations they came out to was because it's all based on the assumption that the acceleration is a constant a. Next, we want to develop two more kinematics equations for constant acceleration that can save us a lot of time when we're solving problems. And the first one is obtained by eliminating t from those first two equations. And the easiest way to do this is to solve for t in the first equation and then sub into the second equation. So t is v minus v naught over a. Okay, then we'll sub that into the second equation. And I'm going to do a couple things in the next move. One of them is subtract x naught from both sides, so I get an x minus x naught over there. And the other is multiply both sides of the equation by a, because that's the only thing I have in a denominator. If I look at this last term in the equation, it's going to have an a squared in that denominator when I square that fraction, but then one of those will cancel with this a out in front. So both of these have a's in the denominators, and those will be cleared when I multiply by a. So my new left-hand side is a times x minus x naught. And on the right-hand side, I have a v naught times v minus v naught plus 1/2 v minus v naught squared. And we're going to distribute and start combining like terms on the right hand side. So I have a v naught v minus a v naught squared plus a 1/2, and then I have to use FOIL to square this binomial, and I get v squared minus 2 v naught v plus v naught squared. And then I see that the v naught times v terms are going to cancel when I distribute that 1/2. I end up with a negative one of those. And out in front, I have a positive one of those, and those are gone. So I get a 1/2 v squared. And then out in front, I have a negative v naught squared, and then I end up with a plus 1/2 v naught squared, which gives me negative 1/2 v naught squared. And now we can multiply both sides of the equation by 2 to get rid of those 1/2s. And I'll go ahead and flip the whole thing around at this point, because we're getting pretty close to the standard form that you would see in a textbook. And I have v squared minus v naught squared is 2a times x minus x naught. And then finally, we add the v naught squared to both sides, and we arrive at the classic third kinematics equation. And that one's done. Now, the fourth equation in the typical list is found by eliminating A instead of T. And the whole point here is that depending on the information we're given in a kinematics question, if you already have a formula ready with one of the variables eliminated that's not given to you in the question, it's going to speed up your work. So I go back to that original V equals V0 plus AT, but this time I'm going to solve for A. And that's V minus V0 divided by T. Then I plug that into the position equation. One of those T's is going to cancel. And I'm going to go ahead and move the X minus X0 to the left-hand side. That gives us the displacement. On the right-hand side, I have a V0 T plus 1/2 V minus V0 times T. And I'll go ahead and distribute the 1/2, and I'm going to factor a T out of these two terms at the same time. That gives me a V0 plus 1/2 V minus 1/2 V0 times T. And V0 minus half V0 is half V0. And I'll pull the 1/2 out in front, and actually I'm going to write as a single fraction V0 plus V all divided by 2 multiplied by T. And this gives us our fourth standard kinematics equation. The displacement can actually be found by taking the arithmetic mean of the initial and final velocity and then multiply it by how much time has gone by. And remember, this only works if we assume from the very beginning that the acceleration is constant. If you have a more complicated acceleration function, you have to go back to fundamentals. Finally, we'll apply these formulas to several examples, and I think I set it up here so we get to use one of each formula. In the first one, we have a car accelerating uniformly from rest. When you see that, you think, oh, the initial velocity is zero, at a rate of 10 meters per second squared for 5 seconds. So we have a constant acceleration. That's good. And we want to get the displacement for the car. So we're going to use the position formula. And if we say the initial position was zero, then that means the final position is equal to the displacement. Alternatively, you could subtract x naught from both sides and say that the left-hand side was a delta x. But typically, you would just set the initial position to zero. We were told it started from rest, so v naught is equal to zero. And all we've got is this 1/2 a times t squared, and I'm just plugging in the numbers as I go. And this gives me 125 meters for the displacement. In part B, we're asked for the final speed, and we use the second kinematics equation for this. V is V0 plus AT. Started from rest, that means V0 is zero. And I'll keep units this time. I'll try to be a good role model here. A is 10 meters per second squared, and we did it for 5 seconds. And one factor of seconds cancels, and this gives me 50 meters per second for the final velocity. And notice the way I said the question was give me the final speed. So subtle distinction there, but I could say 50 meters per second in the positive direction is the velocity, 50 meters per second is the speed. Next, we have a bicycle accelerating uniformly from rest at a rate of 0.2 meters per second squared for 50 meters. So we have a known acceleration constant, fortunately, for a known distance, and I'm asked for the final speed. And so for this one, it's useful to use the equation that doesn't refer to time because we don't know the time. And that's that third equation we derived. It's very worthwhile to memorize that one. And what we're after here is the final speed V. And we know it started from rest. So that's gone. We plug in our acceleration as 0.2. And our displacement, x minus x naught, was 50 meters. And if I think about units for a second, that's meters per second squared times meters. So it's meters squared per second squared. And that's a good thing because we still have to square root to get our speed. To 3 sig figs, that gives me 4.47 meters per second. Finally, we have a bicyclist applying the brakes and slowing from an initial speed of 20 meters per second to a final speed of 15 meters per second in a known amount of time, 2.3 seconds, and we want the displacement. And what we don't care about in this one is the acceleration. So the fourth equation is perfect for this. The left-hand side of that is the displacement, x minus x naught. And all I have to do is plug in the initial and final speed, 20 plus 15 over 2, and then multiply by how long this braking process is happening, which is 2.3 seconds. Into 3 sig figs, I get 40.3 meters, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.